Good morning. Great to have you all here this morning. We got several special things going on, including a baptism this morning. So we had several pews reserved up front for all of you. A lot of family here for that. So very excited about Daisy's baptism this morning. Otherwise, we are continuing our series that we have. We started last week, and on my least favorite thing to talk about, like I said last week, I don't like to talk about Satan because I just don't like to give him airtime. But it's also important that we have a little bit of understanding of who Satan is, and that he is not, you know, he's not just a personification of evil, but that he's a real being that is at work in our world, and to be aware of that, and not to fall prey to his deceptions. And so we'll continue part two of that, which is that his time is limited, one of the things that he doesn't want you to realize. And so we'll continue with that. Otherwise, let's take a few moments to greet one another and share God's peace from a distance. So stand up and, you can greet, you can talk, but stay where you're at as you greet one another. And we'll continue with our opening hymn. Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dearly beloved, Christ our Lord says in the last chapter of Matthew, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit." In the last chapter of Mark, our Lord promises, "Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved." And the Apostle Peter has written, "Baptism now saves you." The Word of God also teaches that we are all conceived and born sinful and are under the power of the devil until Christ claims us as his own. We would be lost forever unless delivered from sin, death, and everlasting condemnation. But the Father of all mercy and grace has sent his Son, Jesus Christ, who atoned for the sin of the whole world, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. And so, Daisy, receive the sign of the cross both upon your forehead and upon your heart to mark you as one who has been redeemed by Christ the crucified. And then we'll pray Luther's, what is called Luther's flood prayer. And it's a prayer that Martin Luther wrote for baptism. So please pray with me. Almighty and eternal God, according to your strict judgment, you condemn the unbelieving world through the flood. Yet according to your great mercy, you preserved believing Noah and his family, 8 souls in all. You drowned hard-hearted Pharaoh and all his host in the Red Sea. Yet led your people Israel through the water on dry ground, foreshadowing this washing of your holy baptism. Through the baptism in the Jordan of your beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, you sanctified and instituted all waters to be a blessed flood and a lavish washing away of sin. We pray that you would behold Daisy according to your boundless mercy and bless her with true faith by the Holy Spirit, that through this saving flood, all sin in her, which has been inherited from Adam and which she herself has committed since, would be drowned and die. Grant that she be kept safe and secure in the holy ark of the Christian church, so that with all believers in your promise, she would be declared worthy of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You know, and the flood has been long connected to, as a foreshadowing to baptism. And I don't know if you've ever noticed this, but most baptismal fonts, you know how many sides they have? They typically have eight sides, which this one here does, that we have here at Redeemer. And the eight sides is intentional because it reminds us of the eight people in the ark that were saved through that flood. And so as God saved them, God saves us through the waters of baptism. And why do we bring children to baptism? Sometimes people wonder that. And I like to talk about that a little bit as we baptize children. And there's several reasons we do that. It's partly because of the fact that Scripture never places limits on who should be baptized. In the book of Acts, we hear every time somebody comes to faith and is baptized, their entire household is baptized. And why is that? Well, because we're all sinners. We're all in need of God's grace. And baptism isn't something we do for God. It's not us saying, hey, look, God, look what I've accomplished. No, it's God's action on our behalf. He adopts us into his family. And so it's God's action. And as we do that, we also, one of the customs that goes way back is to have godparents or sponsors. And that's an important thing. And the qualification to be a godparent or a sponsor is to be a Christian, to have the Christian faith, and if possible, to be present. And so are you all able to be present for the baptism? Obviously, you're here, right? And there's important responsibilities. You help the parents out in several ways. You pray for Daisy. You support her in her Christian faith and upbringing, encouraging her to be in God's Word as she grows up, and to be an example for her. And so this is an important responsibility that godparents share with the parents. And so I ask you, as parents and as godparents, do you promise to faithfully teach Daisy about her baptism and all that the Lord Jesus has taught us? If so, then answer by saying, I will with the help of God. In Acts 2, 38 and 39, Peter instructs a group of believers this way. He says, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. This promise is for you and your children and all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call. And then we'll go through the questions, and since Daisy isn't able to answer for herself, we will answer as a congregation on Daisy's behalf. Do you renounce the devil and all his works and all his ways? Do you believe in God the Father Almighty? Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son? Do you believe in the Holy Spirit? Yes. Okay, bring Daisy forward. Daisy Lynn Embry, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Almighty and merciful Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, has given you the new birth of water and of the Spirit, and has forgiven you all your sins. May he strengthen you with his grace to everlasting life. Amen. Here you can use this white cloth here to kind of help dry her off there. And the white cloth and her white gown that she's wearing reminds us of that robe of righteousness that we are given in our baptism as Christ takes away our sin and clothes us and covers all of our sin with his righteousness. And then we also have a candle here. This, you know, on birthdays, what do? A lot of times, well, we have a cake and we light candles, right? It's a reminder. And so this is a baptismal candle. And just as Daisy has her birth date, now she also has her baptism date. And it's a reminder of that date. And so we light the baptism candle here today from the Christ candle, because Christ is the light of the world and gives us his light. And so we shine that light that he gives us. So I'll give that to you. And you don't have to keep it lit the whole service. You can blow it out once we're done up here, all right? But you'll keep that as a reminder. This is also for you, and it has a number of things in there for you, including a box you can put the candle in if you want. So just to give you a heads up on that. In holy baptism, God the Father has made you a member of his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, and an heir with us of all the treasures of heaven in the one holy Christian and apostolic church. We receive you, Daisy, as our sister in Christ, and together we might hear his word, receive his gifts, and proclaim the praises of him who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. Amen. We welcome you in the name of the Lord. And then we pray. Almighty and most merciful God and Father, we thank and praise you that you graciously preserve and enlarge your family and have granted Daisy the new birth of in holy baptism and made her a member of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, and an heir of your heavenly kingdom. We humbly implore you that as she has now become your child, you would keep her in her baptismal grace, that according to your good pleasure, she may faithfully grow to lead a godly life to the praise and honor of your holy name. And finally, with all your saints, obtain the promised inheritance in heaven through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And so if you want to turn and face the congregation here, and it's a privilege to introduce to you the newest member of God's family here, Daisy Embry. So you can welcome. And we'll finish the last verse of our hymn, and you can go ahead and head back to your seats.
Here we bring a child of nature, home we take a newborn creature. Now God's precious son or daughter, born again by word and water.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I announce God's grace to all of you. Your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Oh. sleeper, rise from death, and Christ shall give you light. So learn his love, its length and breadth, its fullness, depth, and height. For us Christ lived, for us he died, and conquered in the strife. Awake, arise, go forth in faith, and Christ shall give you life.
Please join me in praying the prayer of the day. Almighty God, whom to know is everlasting life, grant us to know your Son, Jesus, to be the way, the truth, and the life, that we may boldly confess him to be the Christ and steadfastly walk in the way that leads to eternal life. Through the name, same Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated as God speaks to us through his word. Our first reading is from Revelation chapter 12, verses 7 through 12. And there was a war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought back. But he was not strong enough, and they lost their place in heaven. The great dragon was hurled down, that ancient serpent called the devil, or Satan, who leads the whole world astray. He was hurled to the earth, and his angels with him. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ, for the accuser of our brothers, who accuses them before our God day and night, has been hurled down. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. They did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. Therefore rejoice, you heavens, and you who dwell in them. But woe to the earth and to the sea, because the devil has gone down to you. He is filled with fury because he knows that his time is short. This is the word of the Lord. Our epistle lesson comes from Romans chapter 16, verses 17 through 20. I urge you, brothers, to watch out for those who cause divisions and put obstacles in your way that are contrary to the teaching you have learned. Keep away from them. For such people are not serving our Lord Christ, but their own appetites. By smooth talk and flattery, they deceive the minds of naive people. Everyone has heard about your obedience, so I am full of joy over you. But I want you to be wise about what is good and innocent about what is evil. The God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. The grace of our Lord Jesus be with you. This is the word of the Lord. Be to God. Please stand in honor of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 8th chapter. When Jesus arrived at the other side in the region of the Gadarenes, two demon-possessed men coming from the tombs met him. They were so violent that no one could pass that way. "What do you want with us, Son of God?" they shouted. "Have you come here to torture us before the appointed time?" Some distance from them, a large herd of pigs was feeding. The demons begged Jesus, "If you drive us out, send us into the herd of pigs." He said to them, "Go." So they came out and went into the pigs, and the whole herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and died in the water. Those tending the pigs ran off, went into the town, and reported all this, including what had happened to the demon-possessed men. Then the whole town went out to meet Jesus, and when they saw him, they pleaded with him to leave their region. This is the gospel of our Lord. To continue with our next hymn, you may be seated.
Thank you.
Christ the Lord of hosts, unshaken by the devil's seething rage. Thwarts the plan of Satan's minions, wins the strife from age to age. Conquers sin and death forever, slams them in their steely cage. Michael fought the heavenly battle, godly angels by his side. Ward against the ancient serpent, foiled the beast so full of pride. Cast him earthbound with his angels, now he prowls unsatisfied. Long on earth the battle rages, since the serpent's first deceit. Twisted God's command to Adam, made forbidden fruit look sweet. Then the curse of God was spoken, your lie crushed beneath his feet. Jesus came, this word fulfilling, trampled Satan, death defied. Bore the brunt of our temptation, on the wretched tree he died. Yet to life was raised victorious, by his life our life supplied. Swift as lightning falls the tyrant, from his heavenly perch on high. As the word of Jesus' victory floods the earth and fills the skies. Wounded by a wound eternal, now his judgment has drawn nigh. Jesus, send your angel legions, when the foe would us enslave. Hold us fast when sin assaults us, come then, Lord, your people save. Overthrow at last the dragon, send him to his fiery grave.
I kind of rearranged things a little bit since I have the children's message and the sermon. I thought, well, I'll do the children's message first. So I put that beforehand. And I was one of the things that I love are card tricks. Does anybody like card tricks or even know any card tricks? I know like a whole bunch of card tricks. Well, I'm going to show you guys a card trick. So hopefully this works so it doesn't look too foolish. But I'm going to shuffle up the cards here. And I was trying to think of a card trick that I could do while social distancing, you know, at the same time. Most of my card tricks are kind of like up close and personal. As you have, you know, I usually have the other person shuffle. And so I would normally have one of you shuffle these. But I'm just shuffling them since... you know, keeping the 6 feet apart and that sort of thing. But anyway, so I'm shuffling up the cards, and I need a volunteer for this that can, you have to know your numbers from 1 to 10, okay? So that's one of the things. And you have to know, you know, be able to recognize, you know, cards, you know, kind of be familiar with cards and, you know, suits and that sort of thing. So do I have a volunteer? And you have to have a loud voice because I'm not going to get real close to you. So anybody want to volunteer? And it doesn't have to be a child. It can be an adult too, you know. That's anyone? Anyone? All right, right here. And so what I want you to do is to think of a number between 1 and 10, okay? So that's the first thing I do. Just pick a number between 1 and 10, and I'm going to predict what number that you're going to pick, all right? So you got a number between 1 and 10? You got it? Don't tell me what it is, okay? All right, and I'm going to show you The top 10 cards on the deck. I don't know what those 10 cards are. And whenever I get to your number, then you remember what card that is, okay? All right, make sense? All right, so here's card number one. If your number was one, then that's your card, all right? Here's number two. Number three. Number four. Number five. Number six, number seven, number eight, number nine, and number 10. Okay. Now, did you catch which card is in the position of the number you picked? You remember which card that was? Don't tell me, but do you remember what card that was? Or do I need to go through them again? One more time. All right. That's all right. I want to make sure I do this right. So, okay. So, number one. Number two, number three, and don't smile when you see your card. You know, I can't see your smile, so that doesn't matter. Number four, number five, number six, number seven, number eight, number nine, and number 10. Okay, so you remember which card is yours? All right, so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to put the cards behind my back. Okay, and then I'm going to pick one card. Okay, I got one card that I pulled out, and I got a pocket in here somewhere. Kind of hard to get to. But I got a pocket here. I'm going to stick that card in my pocket, and I got the rest of the cards here. Now, do you want to tell me what number you picked and what card was in that position? You pick three? Okay, so theoretically, your card should be one, two, should be right there, right? Is that your card? It's not your card. You know why that's not your card? Would you like to know why that's not your card? Because your card, hold on, got to get my hand in my pocket. Is that your card? Wow, all right. There you go. See, I predicted what card you were going to pick. Pretty amazing, isn't it? Unless I flubbed it up enough that you could see how it worked. But anyway, you know, and you know, can I really predict the future? No, I can't. You know, and sometimes, you know, people dabble in things that, you know, with that we don't realize has to do with Satan, you know, things like horoscopes and psychics and things like that, of people that, you know, say they can tell the future, you know. And the thing is there, you know, there's some deception there. And it might just be that they're making things up, or it might be that there are actually demons behind some of those things. So we got to be careful with those kind of things and stay away from those kind of things. Now, this is just a trick, you know. There's nothing. I could show you when I'm done here how I did that. But anyway, does Satan know the future? No, just like us, he doesn't know the future. Can he make pretty good guesses at times? You know, perhaps, yeah. But there's one thing about our future that we know for sure. And we know that because God knows the future and he has told us. Now, there's lots of things about our future that we don't know. But what we do know is we know how things are going to end for Satan. We know that he has been determined for punishment because of his rebellion against God. But we also know our future. We know that God has determined for all believers in Christ, all who trust in him, that our future is secure with him, that we have a future in his kingdom. And that's a pretty cool thing that we have that promise. And so we don't need to make guesses about the future. There's lots of things we don't know about what's going to happen. But what we do know is that no matter what happens, our future is secure in Christ, because he knows that, and he has promised that to us. So it's a pretty cool thing. So, you know, I said, you know, I could show you how I did this at the end of this here. But the thing is, now, it was very important, because somebody, you know, told me this, you know, that if I show you this trick and how I did it, then you have to promise not to tell anyone else how to do it. Now, is that a promise you can keep? Well, it's a promise that I made, so that means I can't tell you. So that's the problem. So, so you understand. Good. I'll come back here mainly because I like standing down there, but I'm told that for those that are online, the lighting is better up here. So that's why I'm coming back up here as we continue with the message for today. And you remember last week I told that one story about Newburgh and how the town of Newburgh was captured, the first town in the Civil War that was captured from a northern state, and yet it was all a deception. If you remember, at the end there, it was the cannons that he threatened to level the town with were made out of stovepipes. They were fake cannons, and that's the way it is with Satan. There's things that he doesn't want us to know. He wants to deceive us. Last week, we talked about what? We talked about how, you know, he wants you to think that he's equal with God. And he's not at all. Who is he equal with? Well, his equivalent is not God. It's not Christ. His equivalent is Michael, the archangel. And so he is not even close to being equal with God. There's no comparison there. And, you know, this week we're going to talk about the other thing that Satan doesn't want you to know, and that's that his time here is limited. As we talk about that, I'm going to kind of look. I broke things down into the past, the present, and the future as we look at the things related to Satan and his evil angels. And so just a quick summary of the past, just to kind of give you, okay, what is Satan's past? Well, he's a created being. I think we mentioned that last week. You know, some theologians say, hey, he was created during the first 6 days of creation. Scripture doesn't actually tell us exactly when all the angels were created, but we know that he was created with all the angels and that they were created good. Unfortunately, Satan was apparently prideful, and in his pride, rebelled against God. And the reason we say, you know, kind of where we get the idea that, hey, pride was his downfall and was the original sin, mainly comes from 1 Timothy 3:6, where Paul, as he's talking about the requirements of overseers in the church, one of the things he talks about in terms of overseers, he said, hey, that they not be a novice, lest being puffed up with pride, he fall into the same condemnation as the devil. And the suggestion there is that, hey, that was the original sin. That pride is what brought Satan down. He wanted to be like God. He wanted to be equal with God. And last week we talked about, hey, he is not equal with God. We're not equal with God. Sometimes we want to, you know, do that as well. In fact, what was the temptation then that Satan presented with Adam and Eve? He said, hey, eat of the tree of the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil. That way you will be like God, right? And so it's that same kind of temptation, that same pride as, you know, the wanting to be equal with God. And sometimes we fall into that. When we don't trust God with things, when we fail to put our trust in him, who are we trusting then? You know, typically ourselves. We're putting trust in our own knowledge, our own thoughts, our own ideas, and we're not God. That's a dangerous place to put our trust. And so when Satan rebelled against God, one of the things that we get a glimpse of in Revelation 12:4 is it says he took a third of heaven with him. And so the kind of the understanding there is that, hey, you know, probably a third of the angels followed Satan in his rebellion. And those of the evil angels now. And so Satan in his pride took us down with him as he tempted Adam and Eve. But then with the fall of mankind, there's the curse. And what's the curse? Well, it's things like work is toilsome. Is work something that was new? No, work is good. But God said, okay, but now it's you're not going to enjoy it. It's going to be tough. The work is going to be toilsome. Childbirth is, you know, was there childbirth before that? Yeah, but he said now it's going to be painful. And so with the curse comes a changing of things that were good. The things that were good now become difficult, become painful, become toilsome, and it affects all of creation, and that's part of the curse. But then with the curse, God also gave a promise, and we get that in Genesis 3:15, where he says, I will put enmity between you, talking to Satan, and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. He, talking about Christ, will crush your head. This is the offspring of Eve. He will crush your head, and you shall bruise his heel. And so we get this promise there. And so he hints at the idea that, you know what, Satan is still going to have some power. He's still going to be causing trouble. There's still going to be evil in the world, and that Christ, you know, his heel is going to be bruised. Well, when was his heel bruised? Well, when he went to the cross. And that's when we see this promise fulfilled. about 2,000 years ago, and probably at least 4,000 years after the promise was made. And so at the cross, we get the fulfillment of that promise that God made as Jesus goes to the cross. And yet while, he goes to the cross and Satan bruises Christ, and Jesus suffers. And, sometimes people say, well, why did Satan, why did he allow that to happen? And not only that, he kind of perpetuated the crucifixion. Didn't he know the promises? And yeah, Satan is intelligent. He knew what was going on, but probably in his pride, in his arrogance, in his hatred for God, he couldn't resist but to put Jesus through that and to put God through that. And yet through that suffering, he has redeemed us, and you and I have forgiveness. You and I have life. Through his resurrection, we know that we too have that eternal life with him. And so that's kind of the history there. And so we kind of move forward to the present. So the history, that's our foundation for faith, right? This is how we know what the promises of God, and that he is faithful in his promises because he has kept his promises all along the way. And so in the current time and now, we struggle with living out that life of love, and we face those temporal consequences of the fall still. We still, work is still hard, childbearing is still painful, and all these things. And yet in Romans, if you could read this with me, Paul writes in Romans 16, "The God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you." And so here, Paul, he's making reference back to that promise in Genesis. You remember, that was made that, hey, Satan's going to bruise the heel of Jesus, but Jesus is going to crush the head of Satan. And when Paul writes this, that had already happened, right? Satan had already been conquered by Jesus. But his victory isn't just his victory. His victory is our victory. And we're still struggling within a world of sin. So the victory has already happened, and yet there's still a victory to come as the complete fulfillment of that comes to pass. And so here, Paul is making reference to that promise, which in one sense has already been fulfilled because Christ has conquered Satan through the cross. And yet we still face those temporal effects of sin. And so he says, these things are temporary, and soon Christ's victory is going to be your victory as you crush Satan under your feet, and you no longer will be facing these challenges, that the time is short. It's a limited time that we have to face the challenges of this world, and we need to keep that in mind. Revelation 12 kind of talks about that, and one of the things there, I'll read this here, and I heard a loud voice in heaven saying, "Now the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ have come." He came in the crucifixion and the resurrection. "For the accuser of our brothers," who's the accuser? Remember last week, the accuser is literally what the name Satan means. And so it's a reference to Satan. "For the accuser of our brothers has been thrown down, who accuses them day and night before our God. And they have conquered him." And so Christ's victory, his conquering Satan, is our conquering of Satan through him. "By the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. They love not their lives even unto death. Therefore rejoice, O heavens, and you who dwell in them. But woe to you, O earth and sea, for the devil has come down to you in great wrath, because he knows that his time is short." And so the time is short, but we endure for a while. So we keep that in mind as we face his wrath, as we face evil in the world now, as we face those challenges. His time is short. This isn't going to last forever in this. And as we live out each day, we face an ongoing spiritual war. And Satan attacks us in various ways. He does it through distraction. He does it through deception. He does it through temptation. And last week, during the Bible class, we've been looking at Luke, and last week was on Luke 8. We're going to continue that in today's Bible class. And one of the things there, it talks about the sower and the seed, and Jesus goes on to explain the parable of the sower and the seed. And we hear about various people who hear the word of God. And during that Bible class, and I'll just kind of mention it briefly here, I talked about how that kind of relates to something that Melanchthon, a colleague of Luther, talked about various components of faith. And one of those is notitia, the Latin word for knowledge. And the This parable really kind of points out those different levels. People who they've heard the gospel, but because they don't believe it, there's no faith that forms. And then the next level there that Melanchthon talks about is assensus, which is Latin for assent or to believe it to be true. And the parable goes on that Jesus talks about and says, yeah, then there's those who believe it, but there's no trust there. And so that faith gets taken away before it ever happens. And is that what constitutes faith, is knowing the truth and believing it to be true? Well, according to James, no, because even the demons know that. They believe that there's a God, that they know that Scripture is true, and yet they are not saved because there's no faith. There's no trust there. And so that third part of faith that Melanchthon talks about is fiducia, which is trust. And that's what faith is ultimately. And that's why when we have a baptism with a child, you know, maybe the knowledge hasn't quite all formed yet. You know, they're still learning things and there may not be those first two things going on as we have limited cognitive ability in a child, or maybe with somebody with developmental disabilities, or maybe somebody with Alzheimer's. But those things aren't what constitute faith. What constitutes faith is that trust, and that is something that is given by God, and that's why we bring children to baptism, because we believe the Holy Spirit can create trust. You know, can Daisy trust you? Yeah, you know, I mean, you know, she was a little nervous when we got up there. She was crying, but you know, Mom and Dad were right there, so that's what trust is. And so on that parable, then when it gets to that point of trust, then it says, hey, you know, then Satan turns to things like distraction, deception, and temptation. It specifically says that the faith gets choked out by life's worries, riches, and pleasures. And so Satan uses these things to try to distract us and to get caught up in the here and now instead of remembering that, you know what, these things are temporary. Satan's time is temporary, and that we have a future with Christ. Sometimes we sort of lose a sense of the spiritual battle that's going on. And part of our fallen nature is that there's sort of a dissonance with the spiritual realm. Sometimes we're not fully in tune with the spiritual things that are going on around us. And one of the things that I think is tied in with that is possession. And you hear that word and it gets used in several different ways. C.S. Lewis says this statement in his book, Christian Reflections. He says, our leisure, even our play, is a matter of serious concern, for there is no neutral ground in the universe. Every square inch, every split second is claimed by God and counterclaimed by Satan. And so everything in life is possessed, so to speak, is claimed either by God or by Satan. And God claims everything. Everything's under God's power, but at the same time, Satan is laying claim on everything. And he says, hey, I want control of everything. And this is part of that spiritual battle that's going on. And so everything in the universe can basically be claimed by one or the other. And that's part of why we have baptism. Because when we're apart from Christ and we're not possessed by him, we're not claimed by him, then who are we claimed by? By Satan. And one of the things that happens in baptism, because, you know, a lot of times we think of, well, being, you know, possessed by Satan, we think of those that are being controlled. We heard about that in our gospel lesson, you know, about the man who was possessed, and it was, you know, it was a legion of demons that possessed him. And, you know, we don't see that kind of thing a lot, although if you go to other parts of the world, sometimes you do see that. You know, sometimes we think of possession in that regard, but anybody that's apart from Christ is claimed by Satan. And so in baptism, you know, one of the first parts of the baptism there, if you remember, is that part that says that we renounce the devil and all his works and all his ways. It's kind of a shortened form of some of the more historic baptisms, and it's actually an exorcism, so to speak, of saying, hey, Satan no longer has claim, but God has claimed this child as his own and is made this child part of his kingdom. And so that's part of the baptism, is saying, you know what, Satan, you don't have claim on Daisy. You don't have claim on us in our baptism. God has claimed us as his own, and we are his children. We are his people. One of my professors in my PhD program is Robert Bennett, and he did his dissertation. He was studying the Lutheran Church in Malagasy and was looking at things related to demon possession. And he talked to a lot of people in that church and found out in Africa, in Madagascar, that these are some of the spiritual realities that they're facing there. And it's a very interesting book. He wrote two books. The first one is called I Am Not Afraid, where he recounts the things that he learned as he traveled to these other countries. But then he, in response to that book being published, he started hearing from people in the U.S. who were saying, hey, I'm dealing with some of these things in this situation. And so he started talking to some of those people and looking into these things, and he wrote a second book called Afraid. And it just helps highlight some of the realities of the spiritual warfare that sometimes we're just totally oblivious to, and to recognize that. But the reality is that God's kingdom is present, and God claims us as his own. Through Christ, through his presence, God's kingdom has come. We pray that in the Lord's Prayer, you know, let your kingdom come. Well, his kingdom has already come, and we pray that we may in turn expand his kingdom by sharing that message with others. And so that's the present situation. The future, which is where we put our hope, which is we look at the promises of God for the future, trusting in that faith of the past and how God has fulfilled his promises. And the future is pretty straightforward. You know, we don't know all the details of what's going to happen in our life, but we know how the story ends. We know that for Satan and the evil angels that God has prepared, and the Old Testament uses the word Sheol, talks about that. In the New Testament, we hear about hell, the abyss, which literally is the bottomless pit. The bottom line is that Satan's time is limited, and God has set limits on that. The future for you and for me is a new heaven and a new earth, and there'll be a day when we go to be with him on the day that we die, on the last day, that personal struggle that we have with sin will be over, and we will be sanctified completely. God's working on you right now through his Spirit, but you know what? We still mess up. But there's coming that day when we'll be made perfect, and we will fully be in God's presence. And read with me that this last verse here from Revelation 12, verse 11. And they have conquered him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, for they love not their life so much as to shrink when faced with death. And so we don't need to fear the future. We don't need to fear and get overcome by worry and frustration because of the attacks of Satan and his angels that take place. We don't have to get overwhelmed with our sins of the past, because we have that promise. We don't need to fear death because God has taken care of that for us. We have that promise of his salvation. We have that promise of forgiveness. We have that promise of eternal life in his kingdom. And that story about in Newburgh, the part of the story that I didn't tell you last week is after that happened and Newburgh was captured, they didn't stay captured very long because word got back to D.C. and they sent reinforcements and they came in and they took back Newburgh. In fact, they not only took back Newburgh, they said, hey, we're not going to allow any more ground to be gained here. So they fortified. It actually, I think they crossed over and took over Henderson. And then they fortified along the river there, along the Ohio River, to make sure that it didn't happen again. And so there may be battles that we lose along the way, but our future is secure. Christ has conquered Satan under his feet, and you and I have that promise of eternal life with him. In the name of Jesus, amen. We already spoke the words of the creed as we had the baptism this morning. And so at this time, remind you about offerings. We've just been collecting those in the back, giving online. And so we'll continue with our offertory.
Praise and thanksgiving, Father, we offer for all things living, created good, harvest of sown fields, fruit of the orchard, hay from the mown fields, blossom and wood. Bless, Lord, the labor we bring to serve you, that with our neighbor we may be fed. Sowing or tilling, we would work with you. Harvesting, milling, for daily bread. Father, providing food for your children, by your wise guiding, teach us to share. One with another, so that rejoicing with us all others may know your care.
We go before our God in prayer. Please stand. Dear Heavenly Father, at times we may struggle under the challenges of this life as we face the temptations, the deceptions, the distractions that Satan and his angels throw at us, Lord. But Lord, we pray that we may continue steadfast in your word, that we may continue to cling to you in faith, to know your love, that you have claimed us as your own in the waters of our baptism, Lord, that you have made us your children, and that our time of struggles are short compared to the eternity that you have promised with you in your kingdom. May we continue to look forward to that and to continue to face those challenges, keeping that in mind, Lord. We pray for those who are currently facing challenges. We pray for those who are struggling with cancer, Lord. We pray for Diana Jean, for Jim, for Liz, that you would be with those who are caring for them and to strengthen them during their struggles. We pray for Nancy, who lost sight in one eye, and pray that you give her the treatment that she needs, Lord, through the medical staff. We pray for those who are recovering from surgery or recovering from illness. We pray for Paul. We pray for Ken, for Phyllis, for Darla, for Paula, for EK. Pray that you would continue to give them strength. We pray for those who are mourning the loss of loved ones, Lord. We pray for the family and friends of Jack Lane. We pray for the family and friends of Walter Craig, who is Donna Klossmeyer's brother. We pray that you would comfort them in your grace, in your peace, in knowing that Jesus is the resurrection and the life. We pray for our schools, Lord, as they continue on here, Lord, and we pray for the parents, for the teachers, for the students, for the faculty, Lord, that you would guide each of them in carrying out their education, Lord. We pray for our country, for all those in leadership, that you would guide them, that you would bless them, that they would lead according to your will. We pray for our military and our veterans. We pray for the first responders and medical workers. We pray especially those, Lord, from our congregation that are serving in the military, including Abby and Augie and Cody and Katie. We pray, Lord, that you may guide us in expanding your kingdom, that through us, that you give us the privilege to share your word with others so that others can come to know your saving grace. And so I pray, Lord, that you would show us the best way to do that, both here in Evansville and also in Newburgh as we look at opportunities there. Most of all, Lord, I just thank you for our baptism, for making us your own. We thank you for the baptism of Daisy Lynn Embry this morning and for making her your child. We thank you for her family and faithfully bringing her to the waters of baptism, Lord. And remind us, Lord, that we're saved not by our works, but by your grace. We pray all these things, Lord, and those things left unspoken in our hearts in the name of our Savior Jesus, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen.
Child, I'll gladly say it, I am baptized into Christ. He, because I could not pay it, gave my full redemption price. Do I need earth's treasures many? I have one worth more than any that brought me salvation free, lasting to eternity. Sin disturbed my soul no longer. I am baptized into Christ. I have comfort even stronger, Jesus' cleansing sacrifice. Should a guilty conscience seize me, since my baptism did release me in a dear forgiving flood, sprinkling me with Jesus' blood. This proclamation, I am baptized into Christ. Drop your ugly accusation, I am not so soon enticed. Now that to the font I've traveled, all your might has come unraveled, and against your tyranny, God my Lord unites with me. Death, you cannot end my gladness. I am baptized into Christ. When I die, I leave all sadness to inherit paradise. Though I lie in dust and ashes, faith's assurance brightly flashes. Baptism has the strength divine to make life immortal mine. There is nothing worth comparing to this lifelong comfort sure. Open-eyed, my grave is staring. Even there I'll sleep secure. Though my flesh awaits its rising, still my soul continues praising. I am baptized into Christ. I'm a child of paradise.
Please be seated for a moment for a few quick announcements. We still are in need of Barna Buddies. And if you know what a Barney Buddy is, then great. If you don't, it's basically somebody who is taking on connecting with one of our college-age students who, you know, maybe have recently graduated high school or that sort of thing. We still need about 12 more, I believe. And so if you are interested in finding out more information about how do I become a Barnabuddy, which comes from Barnabas, his name, who's the encourager. That's what Barnabas means, is son of encouragement. And so it's just an opportunity to encourage, sometimes college students can kind of feel separated from the congregation because they're maybe going away to college or whatever. And so it's just, you know, some simple things, you know, send them a text or an email once in a while, maybe a card, maybe even a care package now and then, but most importantly, to be praying for them and to let them know that you're praying for them. So if you are open to that, give Jeremy a call, contact him, and he would be happy to give you more information on how that works. Also, just a reminder, we have Bible class in here. We'll continue on Luke chapter 8, and then we also have the youth and children's ministry and other parts of the church as well. So I think that's all we've got. Have a blessed week. Go in peace and serve the Lord.